ॐ सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम्. सो वी स्टार्टेड् द 16th चाप्टर् लास्ट् टैम् एण्ड् सो द फस्ट् त्री वर्सस् आल् द दैवीं सम्पदि. एनी क्वश्चन्स् क्लारिफिकेशन् बिफोर् वी गो हेड्? प्रेटी सिम्पल् ऐ थाट्. यु नो रिमेम्बर् फ्याग् एण्ड् आफ् द Gita, this is just about fine-tuning the mind so that once you have the vision, you can make it a fact of your day-to-day life. Okay? So for that, what obstructs you is some of the things that we have in our mind. Therefore, he's pointing it out so that some fine-tuning can be possible. I mean, as a paradigm, you put it as Devim and Asurim, what is divine and Asuric. That's just a paradigm. Human beings are capable of all their emotions. If it is only meant for the gods, then why talking about it to a human? If it is only meant for asuras, why talk about it to a human? Because we are capable of both. So it's a paradigm used. What to highlight, what to strengthen, what to wear off. That's the thing. Yeah.
Swamiji, is there something like human qualities also in Gita?
They are human, but they... Because human beings, we call them human because cruelty, human beings are capable of cruelty. But is that a healthy value to have? No. So that's why. So there are various paradigms used like that. Modern psychology says they're all human, they're all human. Correct, they're all human. But what is it that you're supposed to cultivate? And what is it that you're supposed to negate in yourself? I spoke about this last time also. Integrating your dark side, taking care of it, all that. Yeah. All that comes into the picture. Okay. So continuing now, he's talking about the... Yeah?
Jnana Yoga Vyavasthiti.
Yeah.
Can you elaborate that a little bit more?
Jnana Yoga Vyavasthiti, right? In Jnana Yoga, meaning in your Shravana Manana Nididhyasana is called Jnana Yoga. Okay. Jnana mit Eva Yoga ha Jnana Yoga. What is your yoga, the subject matter? Because yoga has a lot of meanings. Forget that this that you hear in public, you know, there are four yogas. Karma yoga, bhakti yoga, jnana yoga, hatha yoga, you know.
Mm-hmm.
That is a nonsensical division, really. They're all by half-baked scholars they have, or even good scholars, they have brought in these divisions. Big jnani doesn't have bhakti.
Right.
Which bhakta will gain knowledge without, again moksha without knowledge? Yeah, so which student of Vedanta lives without some karma yoga attitudes? And everyone practices some form of yoga etc. for mastery of the mind.
Right.
See, when you say hatha yoga etc., in fact, they have no clue what real hatha yoga is. Okay? Really. They think practicing asanas and pranayamas is hatha yoga. Hatha yoga goes far beyond that. Okay? I mean, sometimes even strong, powerful bodies like mine for my age, some of the hatha yoga practices can shake it all up. It happened 2 Sundays back. 2 Sundays back, yeah. I collapsed and I couldn't take a class, which is very rare for me. Because I have been experimenting with some of these practices. Therefore, when you say Jnana Yoga Vyavasthati, he means in your lifestyle, you are committed to gaining knowledge.
Okay.
Regular, consistent. No? To be regular and consistent with the knowledge. Only then you can make it as part of your day-to-day life. Own it up in your life. Therefore, the regularity and consistency in Shravanam, Manana, Nididhyasanam. Shravanam is in terms of listening to the truth. Mananam in taking care of your doubts, etc. So discussions, questions, or like how you are doing now, clarifying certain things with me. And Nididhyasanam, contemplation, to make that knowledge part of your life. So one who is committed to this is called Jnana Yoga Vyavasthiti.
Okay.
Yeah. So, it's a good quality to have, Devim Sampadim. All right. Then he goes ahead. And he is talking about the Asurin Sampatim now. Dambo Darpa Abhimanascha Krodha Paryusham Evacha Ajnanam Cha Vijatasya Partha Sampadam Asurim. Asurim Sampadam, your Asuric wealth. What is your Asuric wealth? Dambaha. Dambitvam. For the sake of people's respect and things like that, putting on false fronts. Now, what happens when you keep putting on false fronts? In what way is it contradicted to moksha? Because a simple student coming to learn, at least he is in touch with the functional self he is in. This is me, this is what I can do, this is what I can't do. When you keep on putting fronts, false fronts all the time in your acharya, in your behavior, in the way you dress, in the way you talk, you're putting on a false front. After some time, you start losing touch with your functioning self. It's like believing your own bluff. Believing your own press, as the politicians call it. You put on a lot of press releases saying what a great guy you are. After that, you start believing in that bluff yourself. Then even your functional self, you are lost touch with. Where moksha, etc. Okay, dambaha. It's called dambaha. Putting on too many false fronts. So, the image you put in public and what you have as a person, more or less, it has to match. Okay, more or less, at least. Okay, to have a certain reserve, etc., is okay. That's a different thing. Okay. Rudyard Kipling puts it well. If you can walk with kings and not lose the common touch, or be with the masses, nor lose your virtue. You know, that sort of a balance if we can maintain. Yeah, that is fine. That much is okay. But beyond that, putting on a false front, I mean, in the corporate, etc., it almost becomes a necessary. In some fields more. Politicians, it becomes almost a necessary to put on a false front. Though I don't know why. There are many politicians who have not put on false fronts. What you see is what you get, and they have done well. Gandhiji went to one extreme, including revealing private stuff in his experiment with truth. And some behavior which today he would get arrested by the POSCO, under the POSCO rules. Yeah, and I'm not joking. He got away with it only because of his transparency. So many leaders we have had, who their public and private selves were more or less matching. Yeah. Of course, you have a sense of privacy, so therefore, certain things you can keep private. That is not the question here. The question here is putting on a false front. How to avoid that? Be true to what you are. Dambha. Now, a certain form of dressing, etc., is not dambha, okay? That goes with the role you are playing. A sadhu role involves this. A teacher's role does not always involve this, or a sadhu role involves this. Okay? Or your corporate dressing. You dress in a particular way when you are at work. More formal, etc. That is acceptable. Those are all not part of dambaha. They are like wearing a uniform. As long as that is clear in your minds, okay? Long as that is clear in your mind. It's called dambaha and darpaha. Darpaha is unnecessary pride. Some healthy pride is okay. Yeah. Like, I remember I was having a debate years ago with somebody. It's a discussion debate thing. So the person said, a sannyasi is supposed to be like this. I said, see, I'm living a life of a sannyasi. I read the rules, regulations, Yati, Indra, Deepika, etc. I have read. What you are saying is not true. I was born in a family of sannyasis. I said, so the children were born before they took sannyas or after they took sannyas? I couldn't resist that joke. If somebody is telling me I am born in a family of sannyasis, means what? Some ancestor somewhere has taken sannyas. That's all it means. So what are you claiming for that? Are you a committed student? Are you a scholar? Are you a sannyasi yourself? Someone in your family took sannyas. That's all you are meaning by it. No? False pride, excessive pride. I don't think you all can hear, see me, isn't it? The connection is a bit weak. I'm correcting it right now. As soon as my Moto G comes on. Okay, this is taking a minute. I'm sure you all can hear me. And can hold on for a minute or two. Yes. Okay, I think by now all of you can see me as well? Yeah, okay. Therefore, this is darpaha, an unhealthy pride in whatever you are having, okay? I gave an example, it can be anything, okay? Getting carried away by the power of your position. The respect that people show you will be only because of the position. Position gone, you are forgotten. Nobody asks about you. Yeah. Like I remember a couple of us was walking on the road. Somebody came and greeted me and touched my feet. So I also said, Om Namo Narayana. Then my friend whom I was walking asked me, who is this person, do you know? I said, no, I don't know him. He says, you command so much of respect that strangers come and bow to you. I said, no, that respect is for the dress, nothing else. He doesn't know me from Adam. How can he respect me? Or hate me for that matter? It's only for the dress I'm wearing, nothing else. Be very clear about it, okay? Very clear. Yeah. So similarly, many of the things that you're proud about is like that, okay? Darpaha. Abhimanam. Okay. Abhimanaha. This was described in the 13th chapter also. Amanitvam. Remember? So this is talking about manitvam. Abhimanaha. You're touchy. You always wanted to be respected by people and that respect to be expressed in the way you want. You may be respected because you have command over certain things, or you may not be respected. If the other person values what you have, you may be respected. If the other person doesn't value, you may not be respected. If what the other person is respecting value, then someone like me, respecting or has a value for money, someone like me will not be respected. Why? Re kangale, sadhu hai. Someone has respect for wisdom, okay, there is a chance he will respect. So, it's always on the other person's value structure. It has got no reflection on what you are. So, this not demanding respect. Therefore, if you demand respect, that is asurian quality, he says. You talk about democracy, equality, etc., but where is equality in your mind? You are demanding respect for your thing. Why don't you have respect for what other people are? Yeah. But Swamiji, I head an organization and I am an MBA. So I always tell this story to when I talk to MBAs, you know. When I talk to MBAs, I always tell the story. This group of MBAs were taken on a visit to a farm, traditional farm, not a modern thing like, you know. Okay. So one of the MBAs looked at a tree and said, "Your methods of farming are so primitive, I will be surprised if you get 100 mangoes from this tree." The farmer smiled and replied, "You know, sir, I would be surprised if I get one. Why? That's a chiku tree." He's an MBA, all that thing, fine, but he has no clue about farming. So each has got his expertise in his own field, respect that. Therefore, you won't claim extra respect for what you are. Okay. Abhimana. Okay. Krodha. Anger. Okay. Undirected, uncontrolled, unreasonable anger. Asurian qualities. Okay. Because there are times when anger is justified. Righteous anger directed in a proper manner, etc., is different. You don't like injustice, you have certain anger towards injustice. Therefore, if you can harness it, direct it to action, good. If all your action is Facebook posts and WhatsApp, forget it. You're only building up negative emotions, that's all. In the name of creating awareness. The whole world is creating awareness only. Who is going to do anything? The whole world is creating awareness. Karega kon? And they think, I have done my job. One kid goes and screams in front of the camera about environmental. "You have taken my future from me." Goes on. All the cameras are trained on her and she becomes a celebrity overnight. What about the characters in India? There are 6 people who have built up their own mini forest without any government help, nothing, on their own. Thousands of trees. Yeah. Our Coimbatore ashram was barren land when I went there to see it first time. We took 3,000 trees from Bombay, saplings and seeds, and planted it. 3,000 trees and more came up because of natural processes. That is more work for the environment than going screaming in front of the cameras. And our work is nothing compared to what people have done. Forests, many forests are curated. So the need for achievement, not just anger. Okay, you are angry at something, go ahead, get up and channelize that anger, get up and do something positive. Otherwise, that anger is asurian qualities. It only destroy you. Parushyam evacha. Parushyam is difficult word to translate, certain harshness in your behavior, you know? A harshness. You don't have to be so harsh. You don't have to be like a porcupine in all your dealings with the people, you know. That harshness. Oh, it. Why do you have to be harsh with people? Be tough when necessary. Why harsh? Parushyama evacha ajnanam cha abhijatasya partha sambhat. And ajnanam, ajnanam here, ignorance everyone has, lack of viveka. Here ajnanam has to be understood as lack of viveka, lack of discriminative knowledge, lack of understanding what is what, and not bothering to find out also what I think is true. Then what happens? You become a Mr. or Miss Know-It-All. Yeah, sometimes I see this even in full-time students of Vedanta, okay? We have done a 3-year course, we are authorities, experts on the subject matter. I say, champ, have you, you have not even heard of some of the books that are there in Vedanta, you know? You have done a 3-year course, you have the basics, okay? Yeah. Then I list out some of the books. Have you heard about these? No. Okay. Lack of awareness, lack of viveka, lack of understanding what is what. Okay, this is what is meant by ajnanam here. Okay, and not willing to find out also, thinking what I think is true. That is the biggest issue. In fact, that is the biggest issue in people. Successful people don't have that. Successful people are always willing to accept, I don't know and I'll find out. Yeah. I don't know, I never done this before. Let us explore and find out. This is opposite of that, ajnanam. Okay. Then, after having said this, he is clarifying what it is meant for. Okay. Devim sampadim vimokshaya nibagdhaya asuraim tamata mashuchah sampadam devim abhijati osi pandava. Devim sampadim vimokshaya. The divine qualities, devim qualities, are meant for moksha. Asurim nimagnaya, to continue in bondage. Asuri is continuing in bondage. You'll never free yourself with all the asuri qualities. Someone with those qualities, like what we just described, you think he's going to come to Vedanta? So looking at Arjuna, he says, Masucha, because Sivan must have thought, seen Arjuna, like some of the students here, are also thinking, are yaar, some of these asuri qualities are also there in me. That's why I said, remember, they are human qualities. Both sides you can swing. Some of them are natural to be in us. Okay. Mahasuchaja, sampadim devim abhijatosi pandava. Hey Pandava, you are someone with devim qualities, not asurim. Why? Because traces of it we can all find, no? Traces of the asurian qualities described up to now, you can always find in us. So the question is, what are we going to develop? What are we going to tone down? That's all. Remember that story I told you last time? Two wolves fighting within me. Okay. Which is going to win? The one I feed. The one I feed is the one who is going to win. So accordingly, what is it that you are going to feed? Now, Krishna or Vyasa in this case, he decides, thoda asuri mein elaborate karega, maja aata hai. Okay? Because this, if you guard against these, the other positive ones will automatically come up. Therefore, he is elaborating it, you know. Dvau bhuta sargo lokosmin devam asura evacha devo visarasha proktaha Asuram Parthameshram. Bhuta Sargo, in this world, in this created world, Asmin Loke, Dvau, there are two qualities, Deva, Asuram Cha. The Devin qualities, Asuram qualities. Devaha Vistarasha Proktaha. The Devian qualities I mentioned, 1, 2, 3 verses. First 3 verses I mentioned elaborately. Asuram Parthameshunu. Because I have spoken only one verse on it. I have spoken only one verse. So listen to more of that Asurim. All right, chalo. What is it? What is Asurim here? Pravartimcha nivartimcha janana viduhu asura na saucham na pichachara na satyam teshu vidyate. Pravartimcha nivartimcha. What is to be done, what is not to be done. Na cha janaha na vidu asura. Asura janaha na viduhu. They don't know it. Or if they know it, they can't follow it. Pravarti, what is to be done? Nivarti, what is not to be done? What to refrain from? Like Duryodhana says in the Mahabharata, you know. Janami dharmam. I know what is dharma. Nachame pravarti. I can never do it. Janami adharmam. I know what is wrong. Nachame nivarti. I can never refrain myself from it. Yenapi kenapi hridisthitena. There seems to be somebody who is sitting in my heart. Yatha niyojasi tatha karoshi. As he dictates, I do. Yes, let the asurim sampadim overtake him. From childhood onwards, growing up with jealousy, this, that, etc. See, just because you grew up with people who are better than you, there is not a reason to become an asuric qualities. Like the gunman, the boy who shot all those people in states. 2 adults and 18 kids killed. For what? Because he was bullied. Because he had a speech impairment. Yes, bullying someone for speech impairment is not correct. Definitely you should teach your children not to do that. I accept. But does that mean 10 years later you go and take a gun and shoot everyone? What sort of justification is that? What type of behavior is that? You built up so much of negativity, so much of negativity. You became an asura. You became an asura. What else will you call somebody who kills 18 kids? Yeah. Okay. Pravartim cha nivartim cha jnana cha janaha na vidu asura. Asura janaha na viduhu. Na shaucham napi acharaha. No shaucham. Okay, no shaucham. They don't have the cleanliness in terms of physical or in terms of internal life. Slob. To be a slob. To be a bit disorganized, that much is acceptable. Because I am like that. Kids come to my room and they are very happy when they come to meet me. Why? My table is a pile of books and papers. But you are not a slob. Being a slob. Shaucham. Or intention wise. Here there is no cleanliness. Cleanness is not there. Always manipulative this. Na shaucham. Napi achara, even behavior wise it is not there. Okay. Na satyam teshu vidyate. No honesty in their lives. Because all the time they are thinking of how to manipulate people, etc. No honesty. Okay. Be careful. Don't judge yourself too harshly, okay? When was the last time you told a lie? Today morning? Yesterday? We all tell a few, occasional. White lies as we call it. Okay. That doesn't make you an asura. But be careful that it doesn't become a habit. Yeah, that's all. Yeah, asura. Okay. Asatyam apritishtam te jagadahu nirishwaram. అపరపర సంభూత కిం అన్యత్ కామహైతుకం. వాట్ ఇస్ దర్ వ్యూ ఆఫ్ ద వరల్డ్? అనీశ్వరం, నో గాడ్ బిహైండ్ ద క్రియేషన్, బిహైండ్ దిస్ వరల్డ్ నథింగ్ లైక్ గాడ్. అసత్యం అప్రతిష్టాం తే జగత్. హూ దే టాక్ అబౌట్, దే లిసన్, దిస్ ఇస్ దర్ వ్యూ ఆఫ్ ద జగత్. వాట్ ఇస్ దర్? అసత్యం అప్రతిష్టాం. ఇట్ ఈస్ నాట్ బేస్డ్ ఆన్ ఎనీథింగ్. వాట్ ఇస్ ఇట్? మెటీరియల్స్. ఓకే, వాట్ ఈ సేజ్ అండ్ ఆల్ పీపుల్ ఎక్సెట్రా, వాట్ ఆర్ యూ టాకింగ్ అబౌట్ డివినిటీ, వాట్ యూ ఆర్ టాకింగ్ అబౌట్ సోల్ ఎక్సెట్రా, కుచ్ నై. అపర పర సంభూతం, మేల్ ఫీమేల్ యూనియన్ క్రియేట్స్ హోల్ థింగ్, దట్స్ ఇట్. ఆల్ హ్యూమన్ బీయింగ్స్ ఆర్ బోర్న్ ఆఫ్ దాట్ ఓన్లీ. వాట్ యూఆర్ టాకింగ్ అబౌట్ కర్మ, దిస్ దట్ కుచ్ నై ఏ. You don't need a God to explain the universe. I saw a TV serial something. You know, during my channel surfing, sometimes at the end of the day, I also do some channel surfing. Thoda relaxation. Half a dozen channels up and down to see. Okay. So one serial, I found a science professor talking like this. It was a serial, okay, so he's acting the role of a science professor. Saying, see, by evolution we can explain away everything. So the another lady says, but that is a theory, no? He said, no, it is not theory, it is a fact, this. He goes on all about it. And he says, in my suitcase I have samples of 5 million years of evolution. I will show it to you. And he's about to open the suitcase. The lady says, hold on a minute. Hold on a minute. A couple of 100 years back, few 100 years back, wasn't there a time when the best of scientific minds in the country thought the earth was flat? Yeah. But they were wrong. Yes. And wasn't there a time 60, 70 years ago when you thought the atom couldn't be split? And then you all split it and all the nonsense came out of it? Says yes. Then what type of a scientific mind are you if you cannot accept the possibility that you may be wrong on this? Correct? In all scientific theories, one important thing is fallibility. It should have the position of fallibility in it. Should accept that. In every thesis of yours, it should be there. Only then you are succeeding. Next generation can get a PhD. By proving you wrong. Okay. But jokes apart, to not see the fact that there has to be something more than what you see. Science also started that way, that your perception alone is not enough, there has to be something more. But over years of scientific success, many people who are involved in science think that this is the whole answer to everything. It doesn't work that way. That is why science becomes basically materialistic in its outlook. Materialistic outlook meaning that everything is an evolute of matter. You cannot handle the question of consciousness with that. Not possible. If consciousness is an evolute of matter and Big Bang was an event, who was there to see that event? And if there was nobody to see the event, there was no event either. Purely going by science. I am using a very simple argument of science against science. No, but we are going to observe the rays of the Big Bang, etc. now, no? So you mean to say only after you observe will become an event. Before that didn't become an event. So all of us are products of non-event until then. And suddenly overnight we become event. Ye kya baat kar raha hai? What type of talk is that? It doesn't fulfill the paradigm of science itself. Therefore, this type of talk makes you ask, Rick, why, what is the world based on? Something more than what you perceive. Consciousness, etc., that's later. But if you are even denying that in the beginning itself, then it becomes like that. Kama hetukam, everyone is born only because of kama. True, kama is involved in all our births. Okay, kama is involved. In the act of having a children, kama is involved. But a child is born from much more than kama. There is dharma dharma involved. His past karma involved. Your karma is involved. There is so many of things which are non-scientific in nature. And that's fine. Why? A body of knowledge is not restricted only to one. Therefore, if you take it restricted to only one, the other way around also can happen. I saw a video on the YouTube again. This kid asking his spiritual guide, "Sir, in geography in school we are taught that the earth revolves around, rotates and revolves around the sun. Nay, beta, that is wrong. Why? In our holy book it is said that the earth is stationary, the sun goes around. You accept only what is right with our holy book, not otherwise. What is this? These are also asuri. Because then what my book says is right, whatever anybody else says is wrong. Correct? There's even more asuric. At least science opens itself to correction. On verification, etc. This is a verified truth is denying. More asuric. Yeah. Who was the man who destroyed Nalanda? There's an invader, I forget his name. You know how it started?
Bhaktia Khilji.
Yes. Turkey, from Turkey, right? His invasion was from Turkey, yes. You know what the story goes? He fell ill and could not be healed by any of the physicians. Then they got an expert from Nalanda and he healed him. And this man got very upset. Why? There is a body of knowledge available in this country which says much more than my holy book. Therefore, my holy book has to be supreme. Go and destroy that. He actually did that. Instead of being grateful and thankful that somebody came and healed me. No? Asurim. Clear cut, no? Ashkur bulne ka hai. Therefore, if someone helps you and you go and bite their hand, what does it mean? Simple. Asurim. Yeah. Okay. Etam drishtim avashtabhya nashtatmano alpabuddhayaha prabhavanti ugra karmanaha kshayaya jagata hetaha. Etam drishtim avashtabhya, keeping this view in mind, all that we have said before in the last three verses, keeping that as your world view, nashtam atmanaha, you have destroyed yourself, because where will your growth ever take place? Atmanaha nashtam. Alpa buddhaya, you become an alpa buddhi, because what you think is true, nothing else is true. No? Alpa buddhaya. And then what will happen? Prabhavanti ugra karmanaha. They go about ugra karmanaha, doing all heinous crimes. I wonder whether Krishna knew that this is going to happen, all this is going to happen in Kali Yuga in India. You know? The way he is describing, it fits in so much to our historical things. Prabhavanti ugra karmanaha. Shayaya jagataha ahitaha. They are not conducive for the good of the world. They will destroy the world. Shayaya. Okay. I didn't have to elaborate too much. I can go on and on elaborating, but you know, you all know what it's all about. Kamam ashritya dushpuram dambamana dabanvitaha mohad grihitva asad grahan pravantante ashuchi vrataha. Dushpuram kamam ashritya. Filled with endless kamas. Filled with endless kamas. How can you say he is a world conqueror? That means his kama is endless. You know, there is a story about Alexander the Great. He came to India. And as he was going, he had ordered everyone to line up to welcome him. He had very limited success in India. That one king he defeated. Porus he defeated. So in that victory march, he found everyone was lined up. There's one character sitting under a tree who didn't bother. Guy was taken and thrown into the jail. Okay. So the next morning, Alexander the Great went to see him. He says, why didn't you pay me respect? He says, I didn't feel like it. They say you are a sadhu, is that true? You can call me that. What can I give you? Because Alexander was cultured. His guru had told him, when you go to India, see if you can get a wise man to come back with you. He wanted Ganga water, a tulsi plant, and a wise person to come. He said, see if you can have a wise. So this guy thought, probably is. So he said, in India we have a tradition, a beggar does not beg from another beggar. He says, what are you talking? I am the king of kings, I am the world conqueror. He says, Maharaji, my desires are satisfied. I beg down the street. All my desire is for some food to keep body and soul together, I get that. You have so much of desires, you have to come all the way from Greece to India, and still you are unhappy that I didn't respect you. Whole world is respecting you. Got it? Kamam dushpuram. Endless desire. If your worldview is materialistic, that's what will happen. Endless desire. Dambamana madanvitaha. Yeah. Dambam, all that what he had said before. Madaha, demand for respect, etc. And mana, madaha, pride, etc. Pretensions, pride. Yeah. Because you want the world to call you a great person, you know. Mohad grihitva asad grahan, all wrong longings by delusion. See, if your worldview is materialistic and you remove dharma from your life, this will be your lot, no? Pravartante asuchin vratan. They will engage themselves in activities which are not very clean. Remove dharma from your life, see what happens. That is why basic dharma is too important to be left to education. All human beings have an instinctive understanding of dharma. Education, etc., is meant to refine that. Because as a society, if we have to survive, dharma is important. Does a 2-year-old child have to be told to be honest? The child is embarrassingly honest. Na? Remember what I said? I ring the bell to someone's house and the 2-year-old peeps out from behind and says, Mama, daddy wala uncle has come. And the mom, parents don't know where to look. Embarrassingly honest. Kid is. Yeah. Even older. Like I read this essay written by this kid. The teacher showed it to me. In my house, there are lots of books which nobody ever reads. Because you're decor, na? You must have all those leather-bound books as decor. So you don't have to teach kids honesty. You have to show them when to be appropriate, etc., etc., etc. Refinement of understanding of honesty. Love, do you have to teach a child how to be loving? Child is loving. Appropriateness you have to teach. Yeah. So, dharma is instinctively recognized by human beings. Instinctively recognized. If that is removed from your life by some brainwashing, some wrong ideas, etc., then you'll become a completely asuric. No doubt about it. Therefore, when you are struggling with an asuric choice like this, think what would be the dharmic thing to do. Dharmic in terms of your understanding of dharma as we have presented in our classes. Not what society says, not what people says. Okay, not that. That need not be. That can be their understanding. That need not be your understanding. What will people say is part of your problem of manitva. Why you want everybody to respect you and say you are doing the right thing? Why? Why is that necessary? Why is it necessary? Not necessary, no? But we are so brought up to respect public opinion, isn't it? What will people say? In South, we have an expression, what will 4 people say? I think North also says, char aadmi kya bolega? Hai isme. Yeah. Follow dharma, then you are okay. Okay, yeah. Prabhante asuchi imrita. All right, since there is time, we'll see a couple of more. See, you don't have to spend too much time on this, okay? You just have to recognize and see how to overcome it, okay? Chintam aparimeyam cha pralayantam upashritah kama upobhoga paramam etaviditi nischitah asha pashai shatai baddah kama krodha parayanah ihante kama bhogartam anyonartha sanchayan. Chintam aparimeyam cha. Endless worry in your life. Endless worry. Why? People have to respect you, this has to be done, that has to be done. I have to hold myself like this, I have to gather this wealth, I have to do that. How stressful that life is. How stressful that life. It's like trying to live a life so that everybody will like you. It can be the most stressful thing. No, I will live a life in a manner. Nobody should get upset with me. Boy, you'll end up hurting everyone, including yourself, because you never say what you want. Be careful. These are the problems in it, okay? Chintam aparimeyam cha. How long? Pralayantam upashritah. Until your death, it'll be there with you. The chinta will be there with you right until the death. Until death. Yeah. काम उपभोग परमाः एतावदिति निश्चितः. एतावदिति निश्चितः, यू हैव डिसाइडेड दैट दिस ऑल दैट इज देयर. व्हाट इज दैट दिस ऑल दैट इज देयर? यू आर लिविंग फॉर अ लाइफ ऑफ एंजॉयमेंट. काम उपभोग मात्रम, यू डिसाइडेड दैट. Nothing wrong in enjoying the good things in life, okay? But if you think that alone is enough, then the problems start. You have the means to enjoy good things in life, why don't you enjoy it? Nothing wrong in it. Are you getting emotionally dependent on it? Then that is an issue. Yeah. Or you think that is all that is there in life? Fulfillment of desires of only thing left in life, then where is your growth? You become an asura, a rakshasa. Then what will happen? Forget other people, what will happen to you? Asha pasha shatai baddha. You are bound by the ropes of desire. Hundreds of ropes are binding you. Your own desire, you are becoming, desire is a human freedom. Remember this, it's only human beings who have the freedom of desire. Ichha shakti. As I always say, a cow cannot get up in the morning and decide what to eat for breakfast. A cutlet or an omelette, it can't decide. An idli or a dhokla, it can't decide. You can. So that is your freedom. Instead of that, what have you made it? Ropes of bondage. There is no freedom. You have to get it, yaar. Because that's all there is there in your life. Fulfillment of desires. Therefore, asha pashaha. Pashaha, the ropes of asha, desire, binds you. Okay. Shatai baddha. Kama krodha parayanaha. Therefore, your life is full of kama and krodha. Kama in terms of what you want. Krodha, anger in terms of whatever is obstructing you. Whatever obstructs you from getting a desire, you get angry with. Natural. Prasada buddhi, oh, bodhuram. You become normal first, then we'll talk of prasada buddhi. Yeah. Okay, asha vishyate. Kama krodha parayana. Ihante kama bhogartham. Your whole life is only meant to enjoy good things. In your professional life, you're collecting shares, companies, etc. And your hobbies, you know, hobbies, I'm an art collector. They're also collecting only. Grab, grab, grab. When are you going to give something? Yeah. Can you see what is happening? I'm not saying you should be always doing some social work as your hobby. Take to music, take to something better, na? Take to exercising, at least your health will be taken care of. All the karma activities, sort of, the negative effects will become a bit less. Health wise at least. Yeah. But the whole thing. And because of that, anyena artha sanchayan. For the sake of karma, what do you need? Wealth. So by hook or by crook, get the wealth. You get the money so that you can enjoy what you want. Going by public, this thing. By booking a ticket and going in by plane. Yeah, what's wrong? Travel business class? Travel first class? No, no, no. I have to get my own jet. Okay. For what is the advantage of it? Believe me, there is no advantage. I have spoken to some of them. In South, a lot of industrialists have their own private planes, okay? I used to do training programs for Birlas. They have their own plane. And the CEO once very honestly told me, the only advantage is I can take off from this airfield, not that airfield. That's the only advantage. All the flight clearance, this, that, etc., we also need. If I'm traveling commercial, I don't have to bother about anything. I just walk in and walk out. Here I have to tell my admin people to take care of this, take care of that. So what is the real advantage? The CEO, the president of this thing, who was allowed to use the private plane, telling me this. Does it mean enhanced security? Not unless you have government backing for security. A private plane is easy to identify and get shot out of the sky or sabotaged. I studied these things, okay? Take it from me. Take it from me. All right. What I'm trying to say is, for bhoga, you need all this. For name and fame and this thing, position, you need all this. So all your life goes in making money. How much and how long? Ravana grabbed the Pushpaka Vimana from Kubera. Where did it land him? Anyway, that apart. See, using all these things positively. Using wealth positively is not asuric, it's something good. Money is what money does. Forget social service. You're building up industry. Like how the Tatas are done, you're taking care of people. You build up industries, you give employment, you take care of, that is fine. You're generous with your pay packets. That's all great things to do. So it's not against that money that we are talking about. We are talking about that money that's only meant for your personal enjoyment. Then it becomes grab, 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 grab culture. Greed never has an end. Where you're destroying yourself, where is your growth taking place? Yeah. That is all we are talking about. Okay. Enough of Asuri Sampadhi. Both ho gaya. Then next few couple of verses he is talking about attitude towards rivals, etc. Okay. See, he is blowing it up because these are the things we need to guard against and see that we don't have. That's why he's blowing it up. Okay? It is not the money or the karma that is a problem. It is that unrestrained thing and thinking that that alone is life that is a problem. Okay? That makes it asuric, not otherwise. So, good place to stop. See you all next week. Okay. Om Tat Sat.